Hello, everyone. Let's just wait for a couple more moments till more people join. Hello, guys. We're just waiting for a couple more moments till more people join so that I can start telling you guys about the structure of this AMA, the questions that you guys had, and obviously the answers that you all expect. So please stay in here for a couple more minutes, and then we're just going to start. I can see people are joining, so let's just wait for probably two more minutes, and then we're gonna start. Hey everyone, hey guys, I can see you're joining. For those of you who've just joined, we're gonna wait for probably one and a half minute more, so more people join so that we can start our AMA. Louis, hi there. Hey, one more minute, guys. One more minute, and then we're starting. Alessandro, hey there. How you guys are doing this Friday? Hey, everyone. I can see you guys are just joining as well. We're waiting for probably half a minute more, so more people join so that we can actually start our AMA. Thanks for your patience. Yay, more people are joining. So guys, half a minute more and we are starting. We're just letting more people to join so that they wouldn't miss anything. So 20 more seconds and then we're starting. All right. Okay. So, hey everyone. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Anton. So the structure, well, the idea of today's AMA was to answer all of the questions that you guys had, all of the questions that you may have, or all the questions that will arise throughout this AMA. So we're gonna structure this call, or like this AMA or whatever, you know, following way. So there were those number of questions that you guys prepared for us. So we'll answer them first. And obviously then it's just going to be an open conversation. So you guys can post your questions in the comment section and I'm going to answer them. Overall, I believe that we're going to structure this conversation mainly in two topics, right? So number one is crypto. So HMQ in the first place. And number two is actually our hybrid blockchain. There were a lot of questions regarding it last time, and as promised, we're having, you know, a special AMA where you guys can answer all of, you know, all of your questions in here. So I'm gonna read off a couple of questions that you guys had, so please bear with me. The number one question that a lot of people were having was regarding to do with the token price, right? So there were many questions to do whether what's going to be the price of the HMQ, what are the expectations, what do we think, what do we believe. So to make it clear, right, I want to tell you the guys that we cannot and then we should not make any predictions about HMQ token, and especially regarding its price, as it is a utility token. So we're not entitled to discuss its price fluctuations and possible gains. So you guys have to understand that we are working on a project, right? And then HMQ as a utility token, well, obviously it reacts to market expectations. It reacts to the things that are ongoing, but we're not And then we're not going to make any predictions. So none of Humanique employees and then none of Humanique representatives would ever tell you this information. So this is just to make it clear that, again, we're not going to make any predictions, and then we're going to make sure that it's going to stay clear and transparent. And once again, HMQ is a utility token, guys. So it's not about the news that, you know, would make it either direction, you know, to flow. The second main question, so I've highlighted it because I've seen multiple occurrences of it, was regarding to do with exchanges, right? So what plans do we have? What kind of exchanges do we want to add? What's going to be the plan for this 2018, whether HMQ token is going to be listed? There are many questions regarding Chinese and Korean exchanges especially. And so I want to rest assure you that, well, Humanique team has structured three kind of tiers for currency exchanges, right, or for trade exchanges. So the tier one is, you know, most of them are decentralized exchanges, so P2P, so that's where you can list especially ERC-20 tokens, even yourself. Even you guys can do it, just mention, you know, the contract, the correct contract number out there. The tier two are a bit larger exchanges. Most of them are in the US or in Europe. And then tier three are obviously the large, well, the biggest ones, those are in Japan and Korea and in China. Couple of exchanges, obviously, you guys mentioned yourself when you were asking questions. So what I want to rest assure you is that we do plan to work on tier one and tier two mainly. So that's what we focus this year. So we're working on adding HMQ token on tier one and tier two exchanges. Regarding specific exchanges, so the reason why I cannot answer what exchange is going to be the next one, because there is a process, right? So when you try to list your token, and then there's a communication between Humanique team and the exchange, right? So it takes a bit of time. So it's not only regarding the technical part, it's more about business negotiation. And that is why if I'm going to mention a specific exchange name right here, right now, first of all, I wouldn't be able to provide you the date when it will be listed, because it can vary, right? And number two is that sometimes things get shifted, right? But mostly what you should expect, especially throughout the nearest few months, is going to be tier one. So P2P decentralized exchanges. One of which we're working right now is Delta Exchange, right? Next question regarding HMQ token and exchanges, it was to do whether we plan to have any new ICOs, whether there are going to be any ICOs listed or linked to HMQ. So whether we have any other plans on that side. So again, we're not planning to do any new ICO. So any rumors, any statements that you may see out there, those are not true. We're working currently on our product, and then we're working on the expansion. So there's no ICOs that we plan to do. The biggest part out there, so I can see guys, you're joining, so that's awesome. So hey everyone, Alessandro, I can see Mohammed. Well, we can see obviously Humanique members out here. If you guys, you know what, because there are a lot of questions I can see out here regarding hybrid blockchain. So if you guys have any questions regarding HMQ or regarding the product or regarding the business plans or regarding the roadmap that we have, and then the roadmap that was shared earlier in 2018, please write your questions in the comment section. I would be happy to answer them. Now, if you may, I'm just going to shift to the hybrid blockchain, because there were a lot of questions. Mainly the questions were in terms of how it works, what are the expectations, what were the reasons why it was actually developed, and then what are the reasons or what are the expectations of it working. The first and the biggest question regarding hybrid blockchain was in order, what does it really mean, right? So what is it to do? What does even the word hybrid means, right? So hybrid means there's a mix of two entitlements, or there's a mix of two options. So what does it really mean? So in our mind, hybrid blockchain is actually is a set of private blockchains that are linked to the Ethereum mainnet. So as you understand, obviously HMQ is an ERC-20 token. It means that we're still entitled and we're still connected to Ethereum mainnet. What it means is that in order for the emission process to remain transparent, so that everybody can see and track all of the transactions, not just between the wallets, right, but also the emission transaction, we have to remain on Ethereum mainnet. However, as you know, obviously, I'm going to touch the topic once again of the scaling issues. So we've developed a hybrid system. What it means is that we have a net of private blockchains, which are specifically dedicated to each of the countries, right? And then they're logically, so your wallet is your wallet address, right, is logically stored on the dedicated private blockchain. However, all of the transactions that are being performed on that private blockchain, well, they're being batched and then they're being posted to the Ethereum mainnet. So that remains the transparency in this entire process. And that's because those private blockchains, they do not need any gas for the transactions, you know, to actually being run. That creates the solution that we currently have, and that eliminates the gas fee, which is entitled with the emission or with the transaction, right? There are many good questions regarding, so who holds those nodes, right? Master nodes, who is running those nodes? What is the structure in terms of, well, whether you can participate or whether you cannot? So as you know, Humanic wallet, and obviously, well, the transactions involved with those wallets. So all of those things are now being open only in 5 African countries. So we're working on adding 5 more, right, which is still upcoming. However, currently there are only 5 countries where Humanic wallet is open, right? So you can actually access it if you live in and if you operate in those countries. So if you're resident of those countries. Now, what happens is that for all of those private blockchains that run in those countries, there's a set of ambassadors, and there's a set of, again, like government institutions that we are currently, again, cooperating with, and then we're working on many, many governmental questions that arise in this set of world. So what we do is that we actually allow our ambassadors, or in the future, it could be even the government partners, to actually run on their machine masternode. What it means is that they do not have any access to transactions, they just provide the computing power. And that creates, again, the decentralization level that we believe is necessary in order for those for that kind of architecture to actually run. Another set of questions was in order to do whether we should develop. So, you know what, I'm just gonna kick the back in terms of, why did we even create this hybrid blockchain? So why didn't we create our own blockchain and we started working on, on the solutions that we expect or that we need or that our market and then in the first place, our client needs, right? So that when we were architecting and when we were actually developing this hybrid blockchain, there was like one clear idea behind it. So what we believe is that, yes, we can develop our own blockchain, right? And then all our transactions are going to run on it. Now, the question is whether it would be actually as decentralized as you guys would expect it to be. The reason is no. Why? Because if you actually try to compare the computing power or the amount of transactions that run through Ethereum network per day, and then obviously as soon as we would deliver HMQ mainnet, what's so-called, you know, and we will open it to the public, obviously the number of users would be much lower. Yes, the number is going to rise and then the number is going to grow, but then the decentralization level wouldn't be as expected. Now, so in a sense, now HMQ mainnet wouldn't be any different from private blockchain. So that is why we wanted to create a graceful and, cryptographically beautiful solution, which would allow us to remain on Ethereum mainnet. So we would still be open to any updates, enhancements that Ethereum Foundation and then the Ethereum community would bring. And then we obviously actively participate in it. But right, we would still want to mitigate those commission fees on transactions or on emissions, right? So that is why, yes, we still have in mind an idea to bring and create our HMQ mainnet. However, those are far plans, and then what I can rest assure you is that in the nearest 6 months, that is not going to happen for sure. And then if there are going to be any changes in our mind or, you know, in our strategy, or we would find any better solutions, we would obviously discuss that with the community, with you guys. But for now, We're very satisfied with how hybrid blockchain actually allows us to scale our transactions and actually handle that transaction volume that we have, right? I can see, Abhi, yes, I can see your question. So in terms of HMQ, so how secure is it? And then how is HMQ decentralized? So that is a good question. So in terms of, I believe, just to make sure that we are clear, that you're actually, that you're asking about the emission, right? So in terms of how do we mint and emit HMQ, how is it being distributed and what's happening, right? So as you all guys know, the idea of HMQ emission, right? It is based on app usage. So it's an egalitarian approach. It means that with no difference, every user that is being able to create an account and get access to the wallet. So yes, you have to be, right? So you have to be allowed to actually use and open the wallet, which is one of the criteria. Now, there is a complex emission matrix that allows you again to ask you, right? When I mean ask you is actually it all happens automatically in the system, but you're actually being entitled to get the bonus, which is HMQ. And that bonus is actually the emission of HMQ. So that process, right? That process. Now the reason or how is it decentralized? Well, it is clearly that there's an app architecture that allows new users to join. So there's many criteria on your way to actually create your account. And there are many ways to actually mitigate the risk on fraudulent registrations. So that is why there's a BioID part and then multiple other things, which I'm just going to mention a bit down the road. There are many questions about bio-identification as well, but I'm going to touch base on it a bit later. So when the emission happens, when that trigger is actually being initiated, and then when our nodes are actually posting or requesting the blockchain to actually emit or mint the tokens, which is just one of the transactions. So that is based on the activity in the app. So our system, right? It analyzes the information about, well, first of all, your metadata of the phone, right? So whether you're actually trying to fraudulently register. So whether you are actually located in those countries, whether you're registered or whether you're just trying to mask your location. Now, the second thing is whether you're actually a human or a bot. So there's many CAPTCHA ways in there. And then lastly, there's bio-identification. So bio-identification, it guarantees that you are not an existing user or you're actually unique. And then nobody else with your face would be able to log in or register on the platform. So that's very important. And then what guarantees the decentralization is that every emission transaction is actually being recorded and is being posted to the Ethereum mainnet. It means that everyone who actually has the transaction hash or just wants to track all transactions, with HMQ token, you can do that. So you can actually see how many tokens are being minted per day, how many tokens are being minted per week, and then what for, right? So that gives you a security and that gives you the transparency with the HMQ emission, right? Now, regarding the security part, so there are two things here. There's a protocol security and then there's the app security. Now, protocol security in here, we're talking about ERC-20 contract. So that's, again, as you guys all know, HMQ, I repeat, well, I've done it many times, but I repeat it once again. It is based on ERC-20. So it means that, well, that contract has been audited many, many times. The contract source is open source, so anybody can take a look at it. So it means that on the protocol level, it is secured by the ERC-20 contract and the rules that have been signed and then actually been coded when our HMQ token contract has been deployed on mainnet. So it's actually close to a year ago that when it was actually deployed, which you can obviously guys still check. Now, the second thing about is the app level, right? So on the app level, as I've mentioned, so number one, there's the client security, which I've just mentioned. So in terms of whether you're a bot or you're just trying to make fraudulent registration, right? But then what happens if we're talking about, for example, hacking or trying to get access from the internally, right? Or from the externally. Now from the externally, so we've hosted Hack the Wallet. I wouldn't say it was an event. I would say it was a competition rather, in a sense that we were granting $5,000 to the person who would be able to actually get access to the wallet, right? Safely again, so you can still check that the money is in that wallet. And well, if you still want to participate in that event, so please go ahead. All information is on hackme.humanese.com. So that actually gives us a bit more security in terms of, yes, we actually do, we do participate with what's so-called white hackers and hacking community. And there's bounty program. You can actually go on our GitHub and even commit to open libraries that we have, which will grant you more Ethereums or HMQs, depending on the level of involvement. But then what happens is that, so we work very, very hard on the security in two sides, right? So the client side that we've just covered, and also the platform side. So in here, we're talking about the APIs that we open and that are open, and then they are accessible for example, for sandbox environments. We're also safeguarding in terms of any operation. So any activity that happens on the platform is being logged, is being tracked. So there's multiple in-house rules, security rules in terms of what developer has what access to what module, right? And then obviously we're talking about the production, which has very, very high industry standards in terms of security, in terms of, again, policies. So that you can also check on our website, and then we try to maintain that very, very updated. What kind of information, again, we get access to. So I hope I answered your question. So then I'm just trying to cover now all of the questions regarding BioID, right? So the main question was in terms of there are lots of news regarding Bio Institute, so Biometrics Institute. What information is stored on blockchain? What is really BioID? What does it mean? And then what happens? And then whether it is being handled, what does it mean for BioID to be handled? So what are you trying to store? So to answer all of those questions, I'll try to structure my answer in following ways. So first of all, now, what does it mean bioidentification? So we all have our faces and then we all have our cameras, right? So what really happens when we say that you is you or you is not you? Right, so the camera is gathering the picture, so it's getting the visual part. Now there's an algorithm that determines whether your face, right, so something that we see on the picture, it actually has the critical points that match, right, the hash that has been. If you are an existing user, right, then the set of the parameters are of your face. So the level of your eyes, or the size of your eyes, or the size of your nose, or even the length or the difference, all right, or the distance between your eyebrow and your nose, the upper one, the lower one, the jaw, the location of the jaw, the structure of the jaw, right? So all of that creates hash. That hash is a unique combination, and that guarantees that your face is unique, right? In a sense, there are many attempts to hack the system when we were just trying to collect only the face. That is why we've enhanced it a while ago, back in November, and then we also started to track it emotion. So something, there's a live activity, and then imitating emotions, which is much harder when we're talking about pictures or images or static pictures, and not in terms of, you know, real human being faces. So something that we try to track, right? Now, that unique hash is just a piece of information. So it doesn't have any confidential information. Now, even if you disclose that hash, it's just like gibberish numbers and letters. So for example, if you take a look at your wallet address, right? If you take a look at your wallet address, it doesn't make any sense for you, right? So it's just a long string full of numbers and letters. So same thing here. So literally your face, right? So the descriptor, there's a term called descriptor, which is again, the combination of all of those factors. Now that is just the information. So the only thing, the only information that we store about your faces is that descriptor. So we don't really track any images. We don't really store any images. We don't store or we don't provide any images to anyone. But what we do is that we actually store those unique descriptors. And then if you're an existing user, the descriptor is tied to your wallet address and is tied to your, again, user ID, right? So what happens is that whenever a new person or whenever an existing person is trying to register or is trying to sign up, what happens is that we try to analyze the newly came face image, and then we're taking the descriptor of it, and then we're just literally going through all of the descriptors that we have, just in an efficient way, and then we're trying to find matches, right? So if there's a match, it means that yes, your face actually does exist in the system, and then we know that you is you. Or if your face does not exist, it means it's a new person, or you're trying to log into another person's profile, so you wouldn't be able to do that. So we're very confident in that kind of approach, and that is why with new updates that just came in about like 2 weeks ago, so with Humanique.2.0, so we've actually introduced BioID in the wallet. What it means is that whenever you're trying to perform a transaction that doesn't really follow your regular pattern. So for example, we don't know, but all of the information, right, is tracked on blockchain. So the system knows who you actually send transactions to and what's an average amount. So for example, if you're trying to send an amount which is very weird, right, or which is in a sense unique and doesn't really belong to the pattern that you've had, now the system would actually ask you to provide your BioID confirmation. So in a sense that even if somebody in any way will actually be able to get access to your wallet, well, they wouldn't get access to your face. So that's like, you know, the next level of the security that we've had. Now, in terms of, there are a couple more questions, whether or what are the plans? So how do we communicate? What's the next step, right? So, right, guys, you know, it's something like, so, well, hey, you already have bio-identification, right? So you've done one update, so what are the next plans? So currently we're working with many, many industry players. And as you know, computer vision and bio-identification, in a sense, it's a very hot topic. And there are so many developments and there are so many new features, or there's so much precision that is being upgraded or enhanced, you know, pretty much every month. There are more news that computers are now trying, or like they're being able to analyze what is being displayed on the image correctly and then identify what exactly it is. So we're working with many providers, the small ones, the big ones, even if you've heard, well, obviously, Grigori that went to Barcelona not so while ago, he was also communicating with the industry players that were also presented there. So we're open to the market, right? The main idea with the bio-identification is to provide 100% guaranteed identification, right? Which is secure, which is in a sense decentralized, because yes, the descriptor, that's an information that you can actually host in blockchain and then you can just store it there. So you can connect it to the wallet address. You can actually attach it to any other information as you want without storing any private or sensitive data, right? We're also very interested in, as you guys know, it's not my favorite example, but there are so many things or so many issues and questions related and connected to iPhone X. So iPhone X, it has a hardware that was designed specifically for its biometrics identification system. There were obviously many engineers working on the algorithm that would actually precisely use that sensor information to confirm bio-identification, yet still there's so many issues with the biometrics. So what we are trying to achieve, we're trying to go not a bit further, but we're actually trying to spread it out so that the only thing that you would need in order to actually perform the identification, which is based on your face, is just literally an internet connection and your phone. In a sense, that's your, you know, front camera. We're not focusing on high-end expensive phones. We're talking about all kind of phones. Now, and that actually raises questions, right? So that raises questions in terms of whether, what are the network issues, right? So what are the camera issues? Whether camera can handle that, you know, information, whether the channel can handle that much traffic. So there's so many different subdivisions and subtopics that we still have to work on, and there's always room for expansion or for development or for further development. That is why, again, this year we're also working on making the system even more secure. And I believe that we'll be hosting more open events, as we just did with the wallet, right? Trying to actually bring more community in our development process and show what are the updates, what are the developments, and then for you guys to actually get access and then play around with those features earlier. So obviously, if you wish to participate in those kind of events. I've answered most of or the majority of the questions that you guys have there. So if you have any questions right now, if there's any question that I haven't covered, any questions that you have currently now, I still would be able to answer them, guys. So we still have like about 5, probably 7 minutes, a bit more. If not, then I'm just going to tell you guys a bit more, you know, a bit more about the news, a bit more about the plans, if you guys obviously are interested in it. And what I also want to tell you guys that even if you've missed this AMA and then you're going to watch this video later down the road, you can still post your questions under this video. I'm going to be answering your questions throughout this entire week. So I'll be there. I'll be in, you know, in the comment section. So if you're late, no worries. I'll still answer your questions. Any questions related to our roadmap, any questions related to our tech, to our system, to our organization process, or even, you know, to our team, I'll be glad to answer those kind of questions. Right now, I don't see any more questions. There's a little bit of a delay, so probably they're going to come a bit later as I speak. But what I'm going to cover now is there are a lot of questions regarding. So what is the main direction, right? So how do we plan to enhance the app and the platform that is currently there? So to give you a bit more insight, so right now our technical team is working on enhancing the bot. So the assistant bot that you guys have seen obviously in your app. But then what we're trying to do is that we're actually working on bot platform. So that's a platform where obviously third parties or even you guys as users would be able to create your own bot that would be able to communicate either with you only or with somebody else, obviously, if you do allow this feature. So in a sense, that's a big task. So we're working on enhancing our messenger. As you've seen, what we've done is that we've upgraded it a lot and then we allowed for transactions to actually do appear in the chat history. We did add request and add feature. So in a sense that you can not just send money, but you can also request money from your friends. So we're working a lot on our chat platform right now. We're working a lot on our chat and especially the protocol part to make sure that messages do arrive earlier. They do arrive with more precision in terms of whether the connection is unstable, whether there's any issues or crashes, or whether your phone just died, make sure that the information wouldn't be lost, in the sense whether you haven't even sent it, right? So we're talking about drafts that are being synchronized throughout platforms and systems. Probably that's it, guys. I don't see any more questions as of this moment. So as I've just mentioned, you can still post your questions under this video. I'm going to be answering all of your questions throughout this entire week. So if you do have any of them, I would be happy to answer. Thank you very much. I hope you guys enjoyed. And once again, if you do have any questions, even without, with no regards to this AMA, we also have our Telegram channel and Telegram groups or even Facebook page where you guys can actually whether you guys can communicate with us, and if you have any questions, you obviously can ask and we'll be happy to answer. So thank you very much. I hope you guys enjoy your weekend, and bye.